Hi, welcome everyone, and thank you for joining us today. My name is IGOR SESTANJ, and I'm a data recovery engineer at Data Analyzers. Subject of today's presentation is whether we can use machine learning in data recovery. In data recovery industry, we can distinguish three basic techniques. First, there is traditional approach, which most of the companies in the industry uses, is reverse engineering. These days, most of the data recovery equipment and know-how is coming from Russia, Ukraine, and China, although seldom updated, where it's relatively cheap to accomplish such tasks. Reverse engineering has proven successful thus far, especially for some types of failure. The same family and same devices usually works the best. However, not all cases can be restored using standardized equipment, and this is why some companies invest in in-house research and development project. This is the second technique, and this method is especially useful if company has a team with specific skill set, able and capable to resolve specific problem for which solution is not yet available by a traditional reverse engineering method. Good example is ability to recover some solid state drives via disabled serial port, for example. And the third approach is infamous gray key. Gray key is the most, in most cases, is a cracking solution available to small group of people, usually closely connected to the manufacturer via socially engineered channels. Most famous is Apple's gray key. What is common for all these methods is a lack of direct and sincere cooperation between manufacturer and in this case, data recovery service providers. There has been no major changes in which devices we are using to store data. Yes, we can see more and more NAND-based storage devices, but we also see more cloud services, which are mostly based on hard drives. From the perspective of data recovery service providers, we have also seen no changes in absolute numbers of cases per each device. Hard drives are, to this day, is our first choice as a data storage medium. Mobile and various handheld devices are people second, while NAND-based devices are choice number three. What we're seeing is that more and more devices are self-encrypted. Rise of what has been coined as the fourth industrial revolution started changing entire economies around the globe, and data recovery is especially fragile industry these days is facing several major issues. Due to limitation of NAND design, we're seeing more and more complex flash translation layers. So far, example, what has been a solid solution became better, and now we can spend more time with adaptive or dynamic ZOR, adding more value to our service, which reflects in the final cost of our customers are paying these days. Self-encryption, in both hard drives and solid-state drives, this technique has seen its renaissance when the Federation Information and Protective Standard was introduced and manufacturers used this standard to hide internal workings of their devices behind the wall. Encryption also increased data recovery costs to most customers. Complexity of solid-state drives is something what most data recovery conferences are all about. Vendor-specific comments, self-encryption, fancy flash translation layers, etc. Then we also have machine learning-driven flash translation layers. Perhaps 2 years ago, I read a paper from a conference when machine learning algorithms were proposed to deal with the flash translation layer. Thus far, we have not seen many of such controllers, but in the near future, machine learning will handle most of internal workings in many of our favorite gadgets. Traditional reverse engineering will not be capable to resolve issues that will arise from such cases, and more innovative solutions are needed. Shingled magnetic recording, or SMR, leverages the difference in the width of the disk's write head and the read head to squeeze more tracks into the same area than perpendicular recording, or PMR, adding more storage space. Technology uses additional translation layer very similar to a solid-state drive, adding more complexity. And finally, we have customer experience, which is the way how our industry is communicating with the world. We're dealing with products or data storage mediums at the end of their shelf life or after some kind of disaster or accident. Okay, so let's see what the facts are. The first fact, it appears that the current data recovery techniques are not be usable for new devices, mostly due to complexity, cost to develop data recovery solutions, as well as time to do it. As a result, successful data recovery organizations must invest enormous amount of resources into research and development, with sometimes hundreds of hours spent on the development on a single new technique. Taking the time in research and development phase to develop efficient data recovery tools and techniques usually result in lower average data recovery cost to the customer. Second fact is the cost and efficiency. Many factors impact the cost of data recovery from failed storage devices, including equipment, facilities, and human resources expenditures. However, research and development is the biggest contributor to the relatively high price of data recovery. More specifically, reducing the amount of time spent by engineer or technician to perform data recovery reduces the overall cost. The third, lack of cooperation between manufacturers and data recovery service providers is driving our industry to look for new ways we can efficiently resolve the problem and recover data to our clients without assistance from the manufacturer. Which brings us to the final point, right to repair or ability to for end users to repair their own devices. Most of manufacturers these days sees this option as a security breach or hacking, while in fact, locking out third-party service providers, distributors, repair shops leads to hacking mostly due to industrial espionage. In a case of John Deere, for example, cracked software came from Ukraine. Tesla has been hacked using information from insiders, as well as the case from Apple. Hard drive, as well as the NAND and cell phone manufacturers, decided to follow same path and lock out the third-party service providers, hoping internal secrets will remain secret, which will lead to more revenue. Good example here would be Cellebrite, an Israeli company that successfully cracked almost every single handheld device in existence today. So what can be done? Assistance can be provided in a variety of ways, from simple technical specification to specialized manufacturer commands or data recovery specific software toolkits. Establishing procedure for providers on how to become technological partners, accreditation of engineers, preserving intellectual property. For example, we can cooperate in flash translation layer specification, share technical details of any particular FTL. In encryption, we can allow access to appropriate cipher in the presence of hardware level encryption. We can co-develop together, because data recovery engineers can improve system for obtaining memory chips, memory chip reads. We can also have our hands on emulators, or we can be supplied by appropriate documentation of vendor-specific ATA commands for firmware and FTL manipulation. And finally, data sheets, which are seldom available for third-party data recovery service providers. So what else we can do? In order to accomplish this, we should clearly define information and tools needed and find a way to share this information and tools in a secure and confidential manner. Cost, this way we can provide customer a reliable data recovery service in affordable price. Efficiency. Some cases are impossible to solve without manufacturer assistance, while the research and development time required to establish reliable and cost-effective recovery procedure for each specific drive and failure mod is substantial. Hundreds of new drive models are released every year, and drive manufacturers are continuously pushing the envelope in terms of performance and capacity. As a result, successful data recovery organization must invest enormous amount of resources into research and development, with sometimes hundreds of hours spent on a single technique. Availability. Access to these solutions should be available to approved data recovery service providers, and there should be a clear set of rules to follow. And finally, experience. Improve customer experience goes both ways. Most data recovery professionals will agree that if data can be recovered, customers are willing to pay for their lost data when recovery time is not longer than 3 weeks. We can also confirm customers that lost their data and they were not able to recover it will no longer use the same brand or service any longer. Current data recovery tools, including here forensic tools, are not capable to retrieve information from a raw NAND image, even if it was hidden with a simple PNG file, just because it is not written to a file system. Every single tool out there basically relies on a file system signatures, and in our business, thinking out of the box proves critical. Without continuous cooperation with manufacturers, we may have to look some other way. And this is 21st century, so we don't want to miss the moment we're living in, so we decided to try the 21st century approach. Design a computer platform to perform a task, turn it on and wait until it's done while living off a good buzz around it. So why machine learning? The iterative aspect of machine learning is important because models are exposed to new data, they're able to independently adapt. In order to reduce cost, in-house research and development, we need to verify, would it be possible to apply machine learning to some major issues our industry is facing these days? Like we said previously, adaptive or dynamic OR is the very first one. The greatest potential might be distinguishing patterns, such as locating OR keys in a dump and extracting them. There are dozens of OR patterns already extracted from previous cases, and we fed them into the machine learning algorithm and programmed it to help distinguish and locate new OR key patterns. Processes like sorting, carving, and other data manipulations can be improved using artificial intelligence and such. Machine learning could assist with automating processes when the goal is to retrieve data from the shingled magnetic drives or solid state drives or basically any NAND-based storage in general. Although shingled magnetic recording uses translation method very similar to a solid state drive flash translation layer, possible application of machine learning in this case is currently just a model. And finally, we have customer experience, which goes, like we said, both ways, from experience people generally have with the device as such, especially closer towards the end of their shelf life, and customer experience with data loss and data recovery. We hope major changes are possible. Current customer experience and data recovery are based on outdated business models. Machine learning can bring major shift to our industry from chatbots, AdWords, and marketing planning to what I like to call nearly 100% accurate out-of-the-lab diagnostics or pre-evaluation. This is something that I personally started with a free data recovery quote a few years back, and from almost 12,000 submitted requests, we were able to basically distinguish a certain patterns for many devices that basically are now fed into the machine learning algorithm to project a possibility to recover or a cost to recover data or time or the best method to do so. Like we said previously, for the next generation of data storage devices, traditional reverse engineering will likely not be capable to resolve issues, and more innovative solutions are needed, like machine learning. Next generation of data recovery engineers will likely have to deal with more complex math, adaptive electronics, and what we call today thinking machines. Based on what we know today, it appears machine learning has a great potential distinguishing data patterns. So what we're trying to accomplish? Following this approach, we decided to program a machine learning platform with the same set of steps we tend to perform when attempting to recover data. Fed it with the same information and help it learn on its own. I know this sounds a little bit like science fiction, but these days Python is a very powerful tool, and its machine learning libraries such as PyBrain are very good tool to perform decision-making tasks. The biggest issue was to design appropriate database. Information such as manufacturer, model, specification, solution, OR keys, and other mission-critical information had to be well-organized so it can be efficiently used while computing. So what we tried to do, we tried to apply the proven know-how methods to our core program. We're also trying to translate procedure performed by humans to computer software and mimic human operations, using Python, like I said, and its machine learning libraries. Then we basically verified, analyzed, and revised. Our program, an internal program basically right now, it's designed similar to a questionnaire like response. It has like a HTML5 form, which basically are able to give an operator ability to make changes and adjustments during the learning process. We basically analyze the results we got, rewrite pieces of code if necessary, and make it run again. Basically, cooperation with other establishments and sharing the statistical data proves to be critical. That's something that the free data recovery quote project that I started years ago was not able to accomplish, because the data recovery service providers were not prepared to share their statistical data, even if they had only basic information such as what was the cost for this and that device, what was the time necessary, what technique did you use. The first step was to use the text recognition, image and sound recognition, to distinguish type of failure, as well as to be able to recognize the maker and possible model using the sound only. Second, using a database we got from Free Data Recovery quote, we were able to compare pre-recorded sound of a failed hard drive that we already had and pre-evaluate cases before in-lab diagnostic, which proved accurate in more than 95% of cases. NAND failure. Similar to hard drives, NAND-based devices are prone to limited number of failures, which is in most cases are closely related to a make, model, controller, or size. Which brings us again to the very similar approach we used in hard drives, just without sounds. Accuracy varies on image taken, because image of a USB case thumb drive, for example, had accuracy of about 30%, while image of an internal component's image taken from a solid-state drive gave an accuracy of close to an 80%. Major challenge was, and still is, to make a machine learning algorithm for dynamic XOR recognition from a binary samples. From static XOR, we got tremendous success, since the database already contained the keys, and the machine learning Python library was able to distinguish those patterns quite easy. XOR scrambler keys tend to be multiplied by the size of the block, as the controller usually uses a repeating pattern, which is easily recognizable via bitmap view or pattern recognition. Fairly quickly, we were able to distinguish more simple XOR keys, which we find in J-Micron controller, JMF616, for example. It became obvious fairly quickly that pattern recognition library we used is a good start, but requires a lot more work. All of our work requires substantial number of samples, at least 100 examples we like to call in for these solutions, in order to get valid results. Every time we had more than 100 samples, we tend to get better and better results. For the latest, more complex XOR keys, as well as dynamic and adaptive XOR key recognition, more time is needed, as we are seeing ciphers with a rotating key, which is based on LBA. Although due to complexity, it seems this will not likely be possible to distinguish in the near future without assistance from the manufacturer. We will be working on improving our XOR machine learning algorithm, but this work is coming extremely slow, as we have limited resources and not much spare time. So, if you find this presentation interesting in any way, please subscribe to our channel or contact data analyzers. More will follow. Thank you. Have a good day.